commonly misdiagnosed health challenges. Research indicates that millions may be living with small intestinal bacterial overgrowth, or SIBO, and they simply don't know it.
So could your bloating or stomach ache be SIBO, and what can be done about it? Joining us to explain is Cedars-Sinai gastroenterologist Mark Pimentel. Good morning to you. Thanks for being here.
Good morning. It's great to be here.
I think that this is, some people may not like to talk about it, like, you know, especially over breakfast. But the truth is, this is something that I think more people deal with or have somebody that they love that is dealing with this. And people really need to be kind of educated about it. Talk about why digestive issues are so often misdiagnosed and underdiagnosed and misunderstood.
Well, as you pointed out, you know, people don't want to talk about their bowel habits, and that's one of the problems. But, you know, when it comes to IBS and SIBO and some of these conditions, 20 years ago, people used to be told it was in your head, it was psychological, it was due to your anxiety, because doctors didn't understand what was happening to patients. And so that scared people off, and they don't want to be labeled as it's in your head. They believe they have something real.
So we addressed that word before, SIBO. So what is it? How do we identify it?
So SIBO is small intestine bacterial overgrowth. It means that there shouldn't be too many bacteria in your small intestine. That's where you get all the food. That's where you digest and absorb. But when that builds up and the bacteria gets to much higher levels, they're sharing your meal. And you're going to get a lot more bloated because they're going to get fresh food. And we see an association between irritable bowel syndrome and SIBO that's really important.
So there's an association, but they're different. How are they different?
So irritable bowel syndrome was really the condition that we used to label this as. In other words, we don't know what's going on. It's a syndrome. We understand the symptoms, but we didn't understand what was causing it. But now we know 60% of IBS is SIBO. And that's huge because now there are therapies. But more importantly, it makes the disorder now a disease because you actually have a cause and you can treat it that way.
And so I guess the next question would be, how can what we eat help with our gut health? Is it kombucha? Would kombucha help?
Well, it's actually the opposite. In the case of bacteria, they want food. They want anything you can't digest. It goes to them and they start to produce gas and bloating. So we actually call it low fermentation eating. That means you eat food products that you absorb, you digest, leaving less calories for them. Less calories for them means less of them. And that's a helpful way, at least from a diet perspective, to help with SIBO and IBS.
Let me just ask you. So a lot of people might say, oh, I have a nervous stomach, or I ate something that didn't agree with me. Like, you just don't really know. Like, what would be some of the first steps for somebody who might think, maybe I do have SIBO? Should I stop eating certain things? Should I be, like, journaling about things, how I feel? Like, where do you start with this?
Well, I mean, you need to ask your doctor, but because there are tests for this, for example, there's a breath test that measures the three gases that are part of SIBO, the hydrogen, the methane, and the hydrogen sulfide. And depending upon which gas you have, tells you the type of bacteria that are building up. And then it tells you how to treat the patient. And so that's really how we approach it.
That's interesting. Okay, let's talk about those GI issues, though. If you come to the doctor, you're saying you have to ask your doctor. So how do you advocate for yourself? How do you kind of know the right questions to ask, know the right things to explain, like, these are my symptoms or this is what I'm feeling? What's really important?
Well, you know, the problem we encounter sometimes is that doctors are not educated on these new findings, and it's frustrating for patients, especially in smaller areas or smaller parts of the country where there aren't large academic institutions. So the patients have to advocate for themselves, which is why we do these type of programs, or you know, we produce material like a book that we have coming out in April, which will help patients understand what the condition is and even educate the physicians so that they know how better to treat the patient.
And it doesn't really have to be chronic, right? You can kind of get a handle on it depending on your diet. And are there supplements you take? What else can be done?
Yeah, so one of the important things that can be done is to treat the type of gas you have. And usually we start with antibiotics. And then after the antibiotics are successful, then the diet is a very good way to keep from having a relapse, to keep from having the problem return, and then the patient needing more antibiotics. The goal is you treat once and then you go on the low fermentation eating approach so that the symptoms don't come back.
What kind of food would you recommend to avoid that?
So for one thing, the non-absorbed carbohydrates, foods like beans. Beans are the worst. Hummus, for example, is awful because it's very fermentable. And then the artificial sweeteners.
When you say beans are bad, is that because of what how the body sort of reacts to beans, or because of the sort of the nature of the vegetable?
So beans are very difficult for everybody to digest and are often considered gas-producing because they have sugars in them that humans can't well digest, so the bacteria get them. And then artificial sweeteners, sucralose, for example, is zero calories for you, but 100% for bacteria. Hmm. So sucralose will feed the bacteria, making this and the symptoms of SIBO much, much worse.
So interesting.
It's an interesting topic. Yeah.
Thank you so much for talking with us. We appreciate it. Dr. Pimentel's new book is The Microbiome Connection. It is out, as you heard, coming up soon, April 12th. For more on digestive health, you can visit the good LFE.
Yeah.
So like the good life, but no
good
I.
Good life with no I.
TheGoodLFE.com. All right. Thank you, doctor.
Interesting topic there. All right. It's 9:36 this morning.